March 9th, 2017. I'll get to public comment, but first and most importantly, I'd love to welcome our new member, Sam Taylor.
Hello.
You are coming in after we've just gotten another new member, so we have two new members. I believe had the shortest stint of any new member that I can remember.
As a being a new member,
as the newest,
right? So
it's been outnewed.
Maybe quickly we could go around and introduce ourselves. That seems appropriate.
Sure.
Tess?
I'm Tess Poe. I live on Masonic Street, and I own a business on Pleasant Street.
Mark Sullivan on North Street, right down the street from you, and local commercial contractor.
You know, Carolyn.
Carolyn Mish, planning office.
Devin Bruce. In addition to this, we have collateral assignments, and I work on the Transportation and Parking Commission.
John Lutz, I live in Leeds.
Ann Brooks, I live in Florence.
It's a nice representation. Is anyone here for public comment not on the agenda? Nope. So with my glasses on, I can tell you that we are, there's the right piece of paper. We've got a 7 o'clock agenda item for the discussion of street name for Village Hill Circle requested to change to Higgins Way. Presentation, Pat?
Yes. Welcome. Hi.
Tell us your thoughts.
Yes. Well, hi, I'm Pat Goggins, and as a way of kind of describing why I'm here to ask for such a request, a number of years ago I was asked by Mass Development to help them with the naming of streets as the campus at the former State Hospital was being developed, and came up with the idea that that since the discussion about the future of the State Hospital covered the tenure of many different mayors in Northampton, I thought that it might make some sense to name the streets for mayors and past and present, actually. And so I contacted all of the living mayors and asked them if they would be interested. And they all were not only interested but excited. Some of them have been much more involved than others, but as you're all aware, that was a discussion that really took decades here in Northampton, and was an important one for many reasons. At the time, Claire Higgins was mayor, and she had as integral a role in the development such as it is. In the final phases of that development and all the big decisions that had to be made as to what direction it was going to go in. So I went to Claire thinking that would be another natural, and she was uncomfortable with it. Mm-hmm. And so I said, oh, come on, Claire. This makes a lot of sense for a lot of reasons. She said, yeah, I don't know, you know Claire. I mean, most of you know Claire well enough to understand how she might react under those circumstances. Well, so we didn't propose that her name as one of those to be included. And then as the campus continued to evolve, it seemed to make sense again to approach her, which I did, and she again pushed off on it. Then she called me for a favor one day, and I said, well, okay, I'm happy to try to help you with that if you would reconsider once again, because we do have another street that's going to be developed by Pequoy. And she said yes. So I had been asked by Kent Pequoy on the new subdivision that you have approved up there to help him with the name of the street, and so I had proposed Higgins Way, and it was it. I kind of forgot about it. And then all of a sudden I heard that it was going to be called Village Hill Extension, and I didn't understand how that happened. So I called Carolyn. She said, why don't you come in and talk to everybody about it. So it took a while to get clear to this point. It makes sense to me for the reasons that have to do with what we have up there now and the consistency of naming it for mayors. And so I'd like to just ask you if there's a way within your that you could reconsider that the naming of that particular street. I think it would definitely be an honor. It would always have been an honor for her, but at the same time, now she's willing to do it, and I feel kind of silly about the whole thing, so that's why I'm here.
Thank you.
All right.
All the living mayors at the time you started that?
I approached everybody, yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Markowitz won't fit on a sign.
Probably for the same reason that Claire didn't want, as a sitting mayor, to have that happen, and now she's willing to. I remember the discussion, but only in pieces. My memory's not as good as it used to be. And our previous discussion revolved around discontinuous street. Like, it felt like
right.
We were breaking a street and giving one piece one name and one the other. And this doesn't have that, so.
Carolyn, when it was presented, I thought it was extension
same
versus
street.
Circle versus
yeah.
something else, but I didn't.
Right, it did it end up being circle. It was presented as Higgins. There was a lot of discussion about, and it certainly was staff recommendation that you continue the name as it crosses over Ford mm-hmm. Crossing, because it's Village Hill, and then you cross, there's an intersection, and it keeps going, continuing with Village Hill, but having maybe a different ending so that, because there was a whole discussion about would people get confused, and so it is a loop. It's a little bit different from just the straight shot coming up from Prince Street. So mm-hmm. it ended up being circle at the end, I think, because there was
like
loop
that.
And circle. Now I can't even remember. I can pull it up. But yeah, so that was the discussion, and then the board went with it. I mean, Pequoy, you know, asked that it be kept the way they presented it, but it was changed. So they've just pulled a, you know, so it's up to you. The planning board is the only body that approves street names. So it's in your court.
Yeah. Do I have anyone who resists the idea? My, John.
Which I did last time as well, this appears to be a political decision, and we are not a political body. The city council, I'm sure, can name a street if they wish, and that's the proper place for it, not here. It should not do anything to question our objectivity.
Right. would you buy the argument that precedent has already been set and we've named a lot of streets after past mayors?
Not for me.
Okay. Good call. Ann, thoughts?
There's a number of other names up there like that. But this is the extension street that we were looking at confusion about before. This is a new street.
No, it continues. Village Hill continues on. You cross over Ford Crossing,
yeah. Yeah.
And you keep going, and then it's essentially a circle, a dead end, a cul-de-sac.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So it's the same street that we had the discussion about before.
Right.
All right. I think that's all I remember is there might be confusion because it felt like you're on the same street, and then if you're not paying attention, all of a sudden it changes names. But you cross a road, and so it's an intersection, so that happens all the time. And so I don't have an issue with it. I mean, there is a precedent. I agree with John where John's coming from. And if we were at the beginning of this process trying to name streets, I might, you know, throw out Lutz Lane or something like that. but since we're at the end of it and precedent set and Claire's willing and able, so I don't have an issue with it.
Yeah. Jess?
You know, I'm looking at the map right now, and the strongest, you know, sort of issue for me is that it's the same street. I mean, it's, you know, I actually am sensitive. I didn't realize until you just said it that yes, you know, Pleasant Street and King Street are
right.
different, but that does also cause a great deal of confusion for a lot of people. And you know, so from kind of a geographer's perspective, I don't see the value in renaming it. You know, or I wish we could find some other. Can we name the bike path after Claire? Can we name it like Higgins Path or something? No, could we?
It's got a name, unfortunately, already.
What's its name?
The
Norwalk Trail.
Oh. Well, up there. Are you talking about the path up there?
Just the path up there.
Oh, up there.
Yeah.
Sam, thoughts?
I mean, I wasn't involved with any of this before. Given the fact that every street in this town seems to go from Holly to Market to North to Day to Bates to Industrial Drive. It doesn't, I mean, it drives me insane, but I...
Here's your chance.
But, you know, it's the same, and, you know, if all the other streets have mayor, you know, mayoral names, then great. I don't understand the, I mean, the political thing, I don't, it's, I don't understand what politics were involved, but that's mainly because I wasn't involved in it before, so.
Well, and they are not all political names, although
yeah, that, I get
a full
that.
Set of subset that are.
And let me make clear, I have no objection to it being named Higgins Way. I just don't think this is the body that should do it. Uh-huh. I have no objection to the, you know, what they...
Would you want to, Carolyn, revisit your comment? I mean, I don't want to drag this out, but your comment that we're the only body that can name a street?
Yeah, I mean, that's the jurisdiction. It's, mm-hmm. You know, you name... I mean, whenever a new street is created, the planning board approves the name. So,
any history of the council doing that?
I don't know. I didn't look. I don't know.
Okay. I appreciate the effort that's been made to bring this back to us. It seems like it, you know, it had enough merit that it didn't accept the no. And I'm frustrated not really by the changing of street names, but that we always don't put up the street sign for crossing streets. And that's always been a continuing frustration for me, and it's typical of New England, really. I think it's fine because we already have mayoral names up there. But any last thoughts before we call for a vote? All right. Can I hear a motion?
Is there a public comment? Is this a...
Oh, I'm
it's
sorry.
Not officially a public hearing. But I do just want, as background information, just so you know, so there have been a couple of permits already. Houses have been submitted for development. DPW has assigned streets. They would reassign the street name to all the 22 entities that they send out notice of street names. Mm-hmm. So, and they could do that again. They said that. I just wanted you to know that, you know, once a permit has been recorded, the ball gets rolling in that direction.
Well, and are there house numbering issues that take the sequence aback?
Well, so I checked. The numbers would all stay the same in this situation, luckily. So it's just swapping out name for name. The number assignments would be the same.
And it's not going to cost any, it's not going to cost the city other than sending out a piece of mail?
Sign. Hopefully it's electronic, but yeah.
Yeah, okay.
It could be, though. You never know with some of these utilities what you need. I think it's just a matter of sending the message. Great.
Yep. Any more discussion? Can I get a motion?
I move to approve the proposed street name at Village Hill from Village Hill Circle to Higgins Way, as presented.
And seconds? All in favor? Hand vote. Motion passes.
Let me just take a count.
Yeah. First. All opposed?
Okay.
Two opposed, Tess and John. Four passes with the balance of us. Thank you. We have a 7:15 agenda item for the discussion of permit processes. Doug from the DPW is here to, I think, educate us. I'm sorry, I shouldn't be so cute about that. Review the transparency and permits, and basically we've had discussions repeatedly about wet lots, and we look to you to actually give us the expertise, and I've thought that there's no reason why we would ever overrule your expertise, but I wanted publicly for you to explain how you do your work.
And then also just another background, we did receive a letter from a property owner, and Peg is here, so she specifically asked to have a conversation as well, and I think you all wanted to have a conversation, so just sort of tied this all right together. So, and this is, you know, open discussion, not advertised public hearing or anything like that, so, you know, it can be a back and forth easily.
It can. Do I need to open public comment? I mean, open a public portion of the meeting? Okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm not sure if you, Peg wanted to talk first or.
Do you care, Peg?
I don't think so, no.
Okay.
Go right ahead.
We have a technical permit, stormwater permit, that we review for projects that are disturbed over 1 acre. Projects under 1 acre that go before planning board, we also review stormwater systems and other utility connections. So the DPW adds comments to, and sends those comments to the planning board if it's less than 1 acre. And the standards generally are the same, but as a project gets smaller, there's less, you know, the planning board has less authority to you know, require certain standards and at least in the current setting. So I'm going to talk mostly about what happens when there is over 1 acre of disturbance and there's a stormwater permit that is applied for. So in a project, we'll get the same plans usually that the planning board is seeing, and we'll get a drainage report that includes drainage calculations. And we, there's a separate ordinance in the city that lays out how the stormwater permit is, you know, how it's set up and how we review these projects and what standards. We refer to the Massachusetts DEP state stormwater standards. So we review these projects based on the stormwater standards that are laid out by the state, same as what the Conservation Commission reviews projects under. So the critical standards that we look at are the peak flows off-site are mitigated for all storms generally up to the 100-year storm. So there isn't an increase in peak flows. We also look at water quality. Yeah.
Could you just give a quick explanation of peak flow?
Yeah. So every property, even if it's undeveloped, has, when it rains, especially in bigger storms, some of that water runs off. And soils play a very important piece of that. If it's sandier soils, more water goes in the ground. If it's tighter soils, clays, more water runs off. So an engineer will look at a site and come up with a calculation of, before any development happens or redevelopment, how much runoff is there. And they look at soils and surfaces, impervious areas, pavement, roofs, walkways, all those different surfaces, and they assign what's called a curve number to each area, and that then the calculations are run based on that, and certain amount of water runs off a property. So then they look at the developed conditions and how that might change. So there might be more pavement, more roof, and the runoff uncontrolled would be a lot more in that case. So the peak flow that they need to meet usually means that they create a system that holds that water and releases it at a slower rate or gets that water to go into the ground, infiltrate into the ground. So
it's not that no water runs off, but no more runs off at a peak time than before.
That's correct.
Okay.
Right. And it's the peak amount. It's not the overall amount. It's just that peak amount. So engineers have gotten very good at creating systems that can hold that water and release it at a rate that meets that pre-development condition. And those systems, you know, are all over the place. They're all over the city. So we know they seem to function well as long as they're maintained. So there's peak flow, that's a big one. There's water quality. And for water quality, the state only requires that there's something called 80% TSS, total suspended solid removal. So they don't look at other nutrients or anything else. They just look at suspended solids. And so a lot of these systems, the sediment settles out. And so it has to be engineered so that the sediment loads are reduced, you know, from a parking lot. So there's catch basins and there's other structures. There's, you know, there can be rain gardens or bioretention systems that catch that, those pollutants. And then the third big standard is recharge. So recharge is, I mentioned soils and how some soils let more water into the ground or not. A site needs to meet, try to replicate what was happening before the development. Try to get it to some degree the same amount of water into the ground that was getting into the ground before development. So, and that applies generally to sites that have A and B soils, which are better drain soils. The sites that have C and D soils, the tighter soils, the clays, the state says the standard is to the maximum extent practicable. So there's a little sort of flexibility in there because the understanding is you just can't get that water back into the ground when the soils are not good. And we don't hold people to that. We just hold people to what it is described in the state standards generally. We have in the ordinance for the stormwater permit, we do have a clause that we can increase our standards if we don't have the capacity in our drainage system, or if there's a situation that it may, you know, impact an adjacent property, or, you know, we can review it. We haven't used that generally. We try to stick to the standards so that it's a clear process, so that it, you know, the engineers know what they have to design for, and they design to those standards. That's sort of a quick description of the standards. I should say also we require that a maintenance agreement be put in place and recorded with the deed so that these systems are maintained, because they all need maintenance or they start to fail. So and you know, so when we're reviewing projects, a lot of times the engineers know what the standards are. They design them towards those standards. There sometimes questions come up about soils and groundwater levels, but you know, a good engineer should foresee that, should do test pits and understand how the soils are on the site. But there's always some back and forth between the engineer and us to try to work out a system that we would find acceptable. In some cases, we have had to require systems, the Fairfield Inn, we have a drainage system that has no capacity there. So when they were proposing their system, we said, you've got to basically keep all the water on your site. And they had soils that could infiltrate on that site, so luckily they could design a system to do that. But generally, our systems, drainage systems in the city, have some capacity, we think, to them, but you know, the scale of what is being proposed versus the whole watershed of those systems, it's not a huge change usually. But we do, we're working against, you know, the backdrop of all this is that we have drainage systems that are sometimes quite old. They were put in at a time when there was a lot less development, there was a lot less pavement, and they're generally too small. So to try to say that, you know, to try to stop a project and say we don't have capacity in our drainage system is pretty difficult, because you could argue that we probably don't have capacity in any of our systems for the current situation, and then looking at climate change and increased intensity of storms, it gets even worse. So, you know, we have a stormwater utility now. We're trying to build and repair and reconstruct parts of the system to try to make them, you know, bring them up to standards that so that they do have the capacity. Or the flip side is that is to try to do LID and different ways of reducing the flow to those systems throughout the city. So building in, like on Conn Street, we have a water quality swale that picks up the water before it goes to the catch basin, and it goes into the ground, at least some of the water, before it goes into our system. So so to just focus in on this one project on Barrett Street, so that project, it's about 2 acres, and it's in a watershed area that's probably 20 to 30 times the size of that site. So the changes on that site would not have a huge effect on the overall watershed there. But we did review it based on the standards, and the engineers presented a system on that site that it had sea soils, so infiltration was difficult there. It has high groundwater, soils are tight. I think the neighbors had let everybody know that there's existing water problems in people's basements, and so we reviewed it with that in light, and they still were meeting the standards. They couldn't meet the recharge standard because it just it's very difficult. You'd have to build a huge structure to get all that water, try to get it back in the ground, and it just it's not. You know, the state standard is not to push it that far. It would make projects not doable, basically. But on that site in particular, there's flows, sheet flows down through the neighborhood and down to the brook that runs from Barrett Street Marsh and down to Barrett Street. And then there's an intermittent stream in the back of it that flows, come from Jackson Street School and up in the neighborhoods on that side. So lots of water flowing through that neighborhood. The system that was designed picks up a lot of that water on that site, brings it to a detention basin in the back, holds it, and releases it at a rate that meets the peak flows for that. So there was no increase in peak flow to the back of the site. There's a decrease in flows to the adjacent properties. There's a decrease in flows to Barrett Street. And so based on the standards, we granted them a permit. We didn't see, based on the calculations and the design that the engineer presented, we didn't see any additional flow going to the neighbor's property. In some ways, you could say that this project may help the properties downhill from there, because it's actually picking up uncontrolled flow from all the other properties and sending it back to the brook. So we didn't see an issue with it. It did, the one thing, and this is where soils play an important part, and this recharge standard plays an important part. There is an increase in the volume. If you can't get the water into the ground, the calculations show an increase in volume. There's no increase in volume to the neighbors, adjacent properties, or to Barrett Street, but in the back, to the brook, there's an overall increase in volume, but the peak flow is mitigated. So that is one little, I explained to Peg, I think, that's one standard. We don't go beyond that. If we don't see an impact from that increase in volume, we wouldn't push back and say that's not acceptable. And in this case, it was being put to the back of the site and to a brook. So it didn't, from our point of view, we didn't see an impact to an adjacent property or an overall impact to the neighborhood. But it is something that with infill development and with some of these smaller projects that may not put in systems like this, if they're proposing to do something on a site that has bad soils, and soils that are difficult to get the water into the ground, there probably would be situations where we may see a potential for impact to adjacent properties. If there's not a brook right there that you can send it to, or a drainage system that the city has. So, I would see that as possibly one area that we should keep an eye on, and I'd be happy to communicate, our concerns. I think that the problem is that we would possibly issue a stormwater permit. I take that back. These are so some of these sites that I'm talking about would be smaller, under an acre disturbance, so there wouldn't be a stormwater permit. The question is, how do you judge that impact, and is that something that would, that you would want to know, that you would weigh in to your decision? And if it is, we can make an effort to communicate that. And it's something that may change in the standards over time. They're looking at different stormwater standards at the state level and at the federal level. So it may be that there's more of a across the board, you have to recharge, even if you have bad soils, to some degree.
And then just to clarify, so what you're, and I know you mentioned this at the beginning, but to reiterate, there are projects that you all review under site plan or special permit that are under an acre. The plans still go to DPW for their expertise and their review, and they're reviewing it as the city's engineer and sending you that feedback. So you're relying on their feedback, and they do that. If they're not getting a separate stormwater permit, it goes to the DPW
first. That was one of the questions I've got. This is a great opportunity for us to actually ask you things that for everyone else here, I'd like for you to let us do some questioning, if you wouldn't mind, and be assured you'll have all the time you intend to take. I've got a few questions. I'm going to start with Ann, though. I'm going to defer to her from her career in working in water.
I don't have any particular questions. It's very, very difficult with an old system like this. And I, suspect that you probably need more money to manage some aspects of some of these areas where we have slopes that really do push the water around a lot.
Building new systems and building new, I mean, there's slopes. There's actually a lot of our problems are not enough slope, and that makes having a big enough pipe even harder. Because the water doesn't go very quickly.
I can remember a project from the lumber, the unbutter from the over off of it's not Damon, but who's the...
Oh, Holly?
The lumber processor project? Over off near the old Volkswagen dealer, who was talking about the bank caving away from the drainage ditch over off near King and Damon. And so we have neighbors bringing us in those stories, and I think we do want to know what they're going to experience when everything is said and done. Is what we're, you know, it's going to be disruptive usually, but when it's said and done is what we want to be sure of. Any other questions?
Well, I just sort of following, sorry, I was just thinking the conversation Doug and I had previously, and you may have touched on it, is that, you know, the older system that in many cases doesn't have capacity is causing current problems, but these new projects that come forward are taking care of their problem, their issues, right, or their new issues in a way that all the other neighborhoods never had to deal with before.
Right.
So
right. Yeah.
That's sort of that's kind of creating this discrete self, mm-hmm. you know, mitigating project that is in some cases different than the continuation of the continuing concern, I guess, that we have with the old system. So
yeah.
It's and almost as though the new projects are,
yeah.
you know,
but infill
are very...
infill is going into the old systems. I mean, when we were talking to some cases about infill, infill's going into the old systems.
But there's the land is still there that's currently draining into those old systems. And then if a site is redeveloped, then that's the trigger that requires that site to then handle it
right.
in a way that it wasn't being handled in its previous state.
Yeah, and a lot of the, and thank you for mentioning that a lot of the city was developed at a time where no mitigation was put in place. So the water just flows off all these properties. Mm-hmm. So in this particular neighborhood, you have Hathaway Farms, you have Jackson Street School, you have a lot of houses. None of those have a system that reduces that flow or holds it on site. It's all about catching it, sending it as quickly as possible off the site. And in some ways, you know, we over time will probably weigh some of the, do we put in a bigger pipe here, or do we try to mitigate in some of these areas and some of these neighborhoods along the roadways, on school properties, places that we can mm-hmm. to try to capture some of that water. And maybe we don't have to upsize the pipe. You know, we could save money possibly that way. But that's the, you know, so it's hard. These new projects are held to a much different standard than all the rest of the city that was developed at a time where there were no standards for runoff.
John.
Just on the Barrett Street project, I remember that discussion that we had. So when you talked about the volume, mm-hmm. so just to make sure I understand, so there's a greater volume of water leaving that property because there's more pervious surface.
Impervious.
Yeah. Surface. Sorry.
Yes. Yes.
There's less pervious.
Yes.
Surface.
So that. Yeah.
So what you were trying to look at was, well, how much volume is that, and where is it going? In this case,
right.
you had the brook.
Right.
Which provides a convenient, mm-hmm. it can go in there.
Mm-hmm.
But as you said, I mean, as we continue to infill, it almost seems like these, again, like you said, these projects are a little bit different, you know, maybe seemingly held to a different standard, but so what if the brook wasn't there?
Yeah, well, if the brook wasn't there, there would probably be a system that of the cities to connect that to. In most other cases, that's the case. When there's nothing there, I'm trying to think of an example like that. Generally, there is, you know, you'd be surprised. There are water bodies and brooks and wetlands in a lot of places.
Right.
So they're usually not very far. But there may be a property in between that it has to go through, and that's where we get into some harder decisions. If the peak flow is being met, but there's more volume over a greater amount of time, is that, will that have an impact? We don't have it in our standard now, so we can't push that angle.
So the peak flow, if you meet the peak flow standard, that doesn't mean that the water is staying on that property. It just means it's flowing in a way that it doesn't exceed the peak flow standard.
Exactly.
It might just take a week instead of a day or something, you know, whatever. Okay.
Yeah.
Other questions?
Not so much a question. I was just going to say, I know one of the concerns was that could there be or should there be DPW or Conservation Commission representation on the board? And by default, there I see it as there already is. I mean, everything that comes in front of us, we've had legal issues before where one property owner's threatening to sue another property owner, but we defer to legal on that, and that might be a condition on one of the motions that we make. Same thing with DPW. We get their comments, and if this seems like the best project in the world, but the DPW comments say otherwise because of flow issues or whatever, we'll reject it because of that before it gets anywhere. If there's a question, if there's an ongoing discussion, we will condition our response and say, this is approved if DPW and everybody can get on the, if they can make this thing work. And so I don't know that there individually needs to be somebody from the DPW. We have a lot of representation, you know, transportation, you know, planning, construction, you know, I think the board is well represented, but we don't act in a bubble. We act with a lot of input from a lot of different departments.
Yep. Tess, any comments? Sam?
I just have a question. You talked at one point about management. How does a project work with you to actually manage something moving on? Like, in other words, like five years from now.
Yeah.
How does that work? And who's paying for it?
The property owners are. They're paying for it. The agreement that we put in place that has a maintenance schedule is recorded with the deed, so it's legally there and it's legally supposed to be done.
Anyone actually checking?
We check some, but we don't have the capacity to be on them all the time. You know, and we hope that these systems get maintained. We're supposed to receive annual reports. We get some. We don't get all, so.
And if they don't maintain, are there punishments for it?
There's recourse, but it generally has to get to a state where it's in very bad condition. We give them warning, we give them 30 days to fix it, and if they don't fix it, we can go in and fix it and put a lien on their property. We haven't done that.
Okay.
But these systems do start to fail if they're not maintained. And it's hard because some of them are underground, and you know you may not see it fail. So, you know,
and we don't have a tendency to do this, but obviously in a lot of places people are using planting and natural vegetative edges to manage water quality and water flow,
right.
And that is. Usually probably put in more for a quality measure than for a flow measure, but that's another way of trying to deal with some of this stuff.
We've certainly seen projects that had both rain gardens and catch basins, and I would have thought your answer for maintenance would have gone through. I was under the impression that complaints would come into the building inspector, and the building inspector would coordinate with you to say this particular catch basin, I'm thinking of one at Atwood Drive that is never drained.
In the roadway itself?
No, it's behind the
detention
building.
Pond.
It's a detention pond.
Right.
On property. And part of that stormwater permit was to have that catch basin to hold the peak flow.
Right. That, I think you're talking about the one out further down in there.
It's behind, it's on the other side from here.
Their system is all up higher. That's where all the water ends up. And when that's a little bit of a, when the Connecticut River is higher and the groundwater is higher, that doesn't drain out because that's actually the groundwater level there. So their system is up, is that met you know, meets the standards is up higher and does drain.
Okay. I've got a couple of questions, and I'll just, even short answers would be fine. So I just want to clarify that for under an acre, you don't do a stormwater permit, but you review the plans.
We review the plans, yes.
And can you ask an applicant to do more soil samples than they've done? I mean, is that, they come in and they bring their plan.
We can, and we do in many cases.
Okay.
And, yeah.
For one of our infill development, so double lot turns into new house next to old house, it's under an acre for sure because it's an infill story. Would they have to do a test permit for that?
It depends on the system that they're proposing. So generally, yes. If
they're going to propose to go into your drainage pipe because they're a residential house being added in an existing neighborhood.
Are you thinking of just a single-family home?
Uh-huh.
So for single-family homes, they're treated differently. Under an acre, single-family home, there's no, I mean, if they want to tie in to the system, they need a specific permit from DPW, but it's not a whole stormwater analysis, if I'm correct. So single-family homes are sort of a little different than a larger.
We don't usually, we look at each connection permit carefully. We don't want all these connections if
right.
they don't have to be made. In fact, we'd like to keep them not connected in many ways.
Right.
If they can hold that water on their site, put it to a system there, especially on a single family house, it's small enough, and in many cases they can do that. So we try to suggest that if they want to connect, we do allow them to connect.
Right. You know, these are so few and far between, it's not like we're adding many of them just by virtue of the geometry of the town. And I just want to clarify, you actually are doing, you're doing your own calculations to verify a developer's calculations?
No, we rely on the engineer for that project, and we review that and make sure that it's done correctly. And, you know, in the past, it has, we've had to push back and say, I'm sorry, this isn't, the calculations are not right, or it's not consistent with your plans, or it's, you're using an infiltration rate that's way too high. You're never going to get that. So there's a lot of back and forth that happens before they even get to this point and are in front of you.
I guess what I'm looking for is that the inputs that you need are known and discussed, and you
yeah.
know what you're looking for.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any other questions that we've got?
I have one more to comment just about the whole, I think it speaks to Sam's question about the in maintenance, and that is that now with the utility, I think the city is giving credits for systems that have been approved
right.
and which are being shown to be maintained. So in a sense, there's a little bit more potentially of an incentive for people to maintain their systems if they know they'll get a stormwater utility fee credit on the back end, because then at that point they have to prove it. So even if you know that DPW doesn't have to go around banging on doors saying, for every single one of these, did you do your annual report? Because really, they're going to be wanting to have that annual report submitted.
Ms. Murray, do you want a question? Or are you ready to?
Just a couple of comments.
Uh-huh.
Your question on the brook that
mm-hmm.
flows behind, and what if that wasn't there? And it is there, but one of the problems is that brook overflows when the volume is too high, and that creates the wetlands that the Conservation Commission had to address. So that's how that was developed, I guess, over time. I grew up there,
mm-hmm.
and that land wasn't wetlands before. There was a brook, but it wasn't wetlands
mm-hmm.
at the time. the other thing is, I guess, from the abutter and neighbor's perspective, the disconnect is, the first notice we get is that there's a conservation committee meeting, and the subject of wetlands is kind of complex. It's not something that in 2 weeks I can understand fully as an individual living in the neighborhood. And my neighbor and I came to the conservation committee meeting, and from what we learned at that meeting, it was hard to hear the discussion that occurred, but what we did learn at the meeting was no one went out to the site to look at the site. They were inquiring about trees on the property and what was along the brook in terms of trees. And we inquired to see if anybody had attended, had actually gone out and looked at the site, and no one had. And that's a little disheartening. So that was our first step. The second step we thought was the planning board, when we got the planning board notice. But we learned about the about the DPW approving the stormwater treatment. And so my neighbor and I went to visit you to discuss that. And I think the problem was, you explained it well, and I think we understood it. You know, one issue is the developer is the one who digs the soil and gives it to someone to test. There's no independence in that process whatsoever. And I think we understood what you were saying about the soil, but our concern was, you expressed the fact that the planning board is open to discussion. And when we got here, I felt the planning board wasn't open to discussion, because you've said, basically, the DPW has handled this. We have their opinion. Done. And that's my concern about not having someone from the DPW or Conservation Commission more involved in the planning board process, because you're the body we would go to try and either meet a need that we have as neighbors and abutters, or to intervene in the project in some way. So that was the concern raised here, is I think maybe you're thinking of an older planning board before the zoning board changes, zoning changes that occurred for special permits, and you're thinking they're going to listen to you no matter what and give thought to what you're saying and possibly act on that. And I felt we were kind of shut down because they had approved it. It wasn't your job to do that. Go on to the next thing. So the process was a little, there was a disconnect there, definitely.
Can I ask a process question? I'm not sure I understand why the Conservation Commission is where this process starts. Was that just because of this project, or was it? So it was unique, that not unique, but it was characteristic of this particular project.
Whenever
to go to the Conservation
Commission, yeah.
Or is it? If there's wetlands involved, it generally goes to Conservation.
If there's wetlands, okay. So if there wasn't wetlands involved, they would not have gone to. Okay, all right. That's why I was getting a little. Okay.
Any property in which there's a project proposed within 100 feet of a wetland or 200 feet of a stream, the applicant also needs approval from the Conservation Commission. There are, when they're reviewing projects, they are also, they have the same stormwater standard requirements to review with under the wetlands purview as the city does in DPW, for the stormwater permit, I should say. So all the design is going to be consistent, because the standards are the same whether the CONSCOM is reviewing it, but it's just because Conservation Commission reviews it because it's within proximate location to a wetland.
Okay. There is no public comment for the DPW. I mean, I have to find out, I have to do this to go see Doug and who he is and make an appointment and all of those things, and the clock is ticking. Okay.
And that was going to be my next. I just want to clarify. It seems like one of your points is there's no place in that process for input from until you get to here, and then by that time, as you said, you felt like it was that part of it was a done deal. I see what you, okay.
So you mentioned soil samples as not being an independent thing. I actually dug a test pit last year and kept little baggies and labeled the soil, and you can ask for that, can't you?
Well, these projects, the engineer has to witness it, or a certified soil evaluator has to witness that test pit, has to write up a log,
It's a standard thing. It's an ethical thing that an engineer has to present what's there.
And those soils change at different depths, and they document that.
Right. So we don't mistrust that it's a professional being hired. It's not the developer. There's a professional being hired to do that test pit.
But you did say that sometimes you disagree and say, well, so what would cause you, so you get this report from a licensed professional, what would cause you?
Generally, the concern is that they haven't done any test pits, or they haven't done enough,
okay,
or haven't done them in the right place where they're proposing to put a system.
And so, we've seen that a couple times when applicants have asked for us to allow them to not do additional test pits, and we've refused. I mean, I believe we've always been consistent in saying if they're required, they're required. You don't get a pass on that, because it's an important piece of data.
It's a really important thing. I to this day, I don't understand why any engineer would design something without figuring out what the soils are and doing a test pit. And a lot of times I have to remind them that you shouldn't have designed this until you knew what was going on in the ground.
Well, that came up with Village Hill, the last division, that there was a lot of staff level conversation with the applicant prior to getting to the board, and we actually wouldn't allow the project to move forward until we had more data, specifically for where things were being proposed, so because there was no way to confirm that the design would meet the standards without that underlying data. So that happens. It's not just, you know, one or two projects, but it can happen anywhere.
So on this project, interestingly enough, they did do test pits. If they had used the NRCS soil information, you can get soil information on any site, and it said it was C in the back and B in the front. If they had used that information, they may have designed a system that they thought could actually do much more than when they did the test pits before they designed it and found it was clay and really tight soils and in all around. So the front, that was not correct, what they were getting, you know, sort of the canned wet soils on site. So, you know, in that case, they did their due diligence and did test pits and found that soils were not good and had to design around that, had to build the system at, you know, up above the groundwater, which was only 2 feet below the surface, kind of like a, you know, a mound septic system in some ways. So they had to, you know, they seemed to do the right thing. They seemed to figure out what was going on with the soils and then design a system that would work under those circumstances.
And then on sometimes on the back end, when they do a soil analysis, you might get an overly aggressive engineer whose calcs might be a little too optimistic, but you, based on the soil analysis, you call that.
Right.
And
There's a set way of, especially for infiltration, there's a table they have to use. Whatever soil texture it is, there's a rate that they have to use that is pretty conservative. It's not... some engineers have tried to do a perk test, which is what's done for a septic system, and it's a very different thing for an infiltration, a stormwater infiltration system. And we don't accept perk tests for that. They can, in the past, engineers have tried to design systems based on one perk test that, and then just set the rate based on that one finding, and it's usually exaggerated.
And the fact that you're saying, oh, we are all set, we did get the DPW's opinion, but there's no avenue for the public.
I get that. What was there ever an avenue for the public in that with a DPW process?
No.
CONSCOM meeting or a DPW has reviewed or something?
No. I mean, this is a highly technical review, so you're looking at standards, there are certain code requirements, there's engineer specifications. So staff is looking at this technical submittal and evaluating it against the criteria. And that's not really considered a subjective analysis. So from a stormwater perspective, you know, meaning the city relies on the expertise of the engineers and oversight from staff to make sure all the little pieces are put together in the right place. So that's not considered a place for subjective review where it makes sense to have public comment, because there may be people who live in the neighborhood who understand what they see on the surface for water flow, but that doesn't translate well to actually the system that's created to address that based on those very detailed.
But I understand that it's not a subjective thing, it's a technical thing. But also, I think what I'm hearing, Peg, is that also leads to kind of a lack of understanding of just, you know, I don't know that abutters are always looking for you to change, but I'd least like to, you know, if it was happening next to my, you know, I might at least understand, oh, you went through the process, this is what the process told you, so I can know as much as anybody else knows. I think it's more just a, you know, like you said, there's no point.
The neighbors came to the planning board
right.
thinking this is the place to and focus.
Yes. You know, the obvious thing to say is that we want to talk about what has happened to get the permit to the developer. But I would have to tell you, I have no expertise in running the engineering calculations, and I'm sure you would understand that. But you're right in that your ability to approach the project happens here. And so I can feel that it's frustrating to say, well, but you've already done that assessment. I'm actually pleased, I thank you for spending time trying to explain what is a very technical process. And I would tell you that I rely on the permit being issued. I just have to. That's the point of it. That's why we have the standards. They came from the state. The city exercises it. They issue a permit.
And you know the other
yeah
right. And but the other piece of that is to take it to its next conclusion is that if we're issuing a legally binding permit, you know, if we, you know, again, I have training in city planning and economic development, not in stormwater. You know, if you know, we were to make a decision that is not consistent with what the experts have said, you know, that could open the city up to a legal challenge from the developer to say, you know, what is your basis for,
right.
you know, requiring this additional standard, or, you know, so that's, you know, in terms of, I think, where some of us come from in relying on the, you know, the sort of assessment of stormwater. I read as much of the report as I can before I, you know, my eyes kind of glaze over. I'm sorry, but but you know, there. I think we are, you know, always trying to hear abutters' concerns and understand that it's often for many abutters a very you know, sort of sudden thing. You know, you get this letter in the mail and you're kind of like, I didn't realize that, you know, that this is land that could be potentially developed, and then suddenly, you know, you have a date and a time on the calendar, but we're balancing that with our legal responsibility to act on behalf of the city, you know, in enforcing, you know, the
well,
code
and
ordinances.
For a special permit in this case.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Could we? Right. I don't know with the letter. I mean, you know, I've gotten those letters. I mean, could we create the opportunity? You know, if you wish, and have an abutter who wants to come to the meeting. Have their ability to request that the DPW is here, as opposed to just having their report that there's a person here who could actually, like, I have a question, or I have not necessarily, I mean, obviously, you know, you do your calculations and they're what they are, and I got to change them. But again, to give that opportunity, like, oh, can you help me understand this a little bit more? Because I think it is so often people, you know,
right.
The eye test says this, and yet, so they're like trying to understand. I mean, and we've heard that so many times, like, well, I've lived in this neighborhood, and now my, you know, I mean, people, this is what my basement does.
Right.
So I don't, is there a way to say, if you'd like a representative of DPW there, when you come to the meeting, you know, we'll get somebody to come, you know.
Could we make a video?
What's that?
Could we make an explanatory video? Like, everything you've just explained is actually really useful. Yeah, like, you know, some kind of preliminary, like, here are the things that you're going to hear if you are interested in this project and you're planning on coming, you know, so that it's far enough in advance that you could digest it. And
I
don't think we can ask other departments to send staff to the planning board meetings for, you know, on an ad hoc basis. I think the best way to get that contact is actually what Ms. Murray did, was contact DPW and schedule an appointment or talk on the phone. I don't remember what it was, but that's a certainly a valid thing to do. And of course, the other thing that we have encouraged applicants to do is to reach out to the abutting neighbors before the notice goes out. So there's more than just a 2-week notification. And I think that helps a lot. Sometimes there's a lot of friction there and it doesn't work out so well. But that's also another thing that I think is beneficial when applicants do.
I think we certainly recognize developers that do that, when they come in and they can show that they have had those neighborhood meetings, I care about that.
I think we had that particular issue, though, where I had to call Carolyn multiple times to contact the developer because we weren't having that conversation,
right?
And it wasn't possible to. So
there's
that makes a big
why
difference.
Wasn't it possible to?
No.
Why? Wasn't the developer just wouldn't.
Developers allowed to decide how they're gonna. I mean, they could be that kind of developer or not. I mean, it's a private person.
Yeah, which brings me to one other piece of this, and that is that over the years, I have felt like the neighborhood coalesces around. We can make this go a different way than it's going, and sometimes I get a sense that the public thinks we can do more things than we can do. I mean, we are bound by a set of rules for site plan and special permit. They're different, but if the projects are within those rules, that's been decided before the project comes before us. And so I think there's a piece of that it's not the problem you're talking about, but it's one that I've experienced when we are talking to people and saying, but we can't keep that from happening. You know, that's within their ability.
I think that's a good point. I think two cases, this one and say the Cumberland Farms and the Center of Florence, that was a special permit. They met all the regulations. There was nothing technically that would have prevented us from approving it, but we didn't think as a board it was the right development in that space. Right. And for a bunch of reasons. And as a special permit review, we rejected it. And ultimately, we're thankful that it went that way. In this case, same thing, special permit review, but it wasn't an esoteric discussion on what wants to be there in the center of Florence. Does, you know, what's the massing of the building and so forth? It ended up to be a technical review. There was a lot of concern by the abutters about water flow and so forth. But the only data that we had, to your point, we can't really. We have to go off something, so we go off that, and we say, so we understand the concerns, we get it's an issue, but the calcs are saying, and the DPW are backing up the calcs, that it's this system is going to work, and so that's what we have to base our decision on. And so we go in kind of two different directions because we have to follow a certain set of rules. And so I certainly understand where you're coming from, and I can sense the frustration, but I don't know
If
the whole neighborhood showed up and everybody was, you know, they had posters of us and with big red, you know, circles, crosses, and it was horrible. But ultimately, we have to make a decision based on the information we have, and we would defer to the DPW. And if there weren't any comments, if they say this system works, we would approve it, I think.
But is there room? I mean, I think I guess I'm, and this is my first day, so you'll excuse me, but I think the eye test is not always wrong. And the notion that somehow the eye test cannot inform actual data is nonsense. And so I guess to me, there's a point at which the public, the eye test is often wrong, But the public needs to be able to input that, give you more data points so that we can actually make the right choice. And so I guess my question is, it seems like you want a place where the public can try to add data points. Those data points can be right or wrong. And then we can actually have, we can, at that point, we will have, I guess, a more educated.
I'm uncomfortable with an eye test by an abutter being a data point for an assessment of a permit. That is,
why?
Well, because how do you visually know you saw peak flow?
Well, I guess my point is not, I think that's my point. My point is not that they're, you know, that I see something, so it is. My point is that if you just say, I have the data because the engineer from the developer said, this is what the data is, that's just not a very good way of doing it. You can say, this is the set of data, this is another set of data, this is another set of data, this is not correct. Data is not correct because it's data. That's not the case. It's just not correct.
Well, I think there are data points that get collected from the neighborhood all the time and brought to the planning board, but there's some that can't be used to then counter or evaluate some technical standards. So there may be other issues that the neighborhood can bring.
Of course.
So taking a step back, the stormwater analysis is one piece of a project. So it may be that there, you know, I would say that we need, as a city, to be on firm ground. We have standards. We have professional engineers who are trained in this to provide a design. And the city needs to evaluate that application, say, does it meet it, does it not? And that's sort of the box for stormwater. If someone from the neighborhood says, but I see this water here and I'm concerned, there are answers probably within that design that can address that. And then that's one piece of the project. Then there's traffic, there's design, there's landscaping. All that other stuff, absolutely, I think, makes sense that you all, and you continue to do that, is take information from the neighborhood about things that can be, that would make a project better or that maybe make a project not so great, so it needs to be mitigated or, you know, sized, scaled differently or designed differently. But I don't think that you can necessarily take, you know, information and apply it to every single aspect of the project, especially the very technical ones.
I don't feel like I'm saying that. I'm saying that it seems like the concern is, and I guess I feel like it's a very valid concern, that there's a place where, and I'm not saying that we're, I mean, if someone tells me that this is what the stormwater thing is, I'm going to believe it. Why wouldn't I believe it? But I do think that there's a place for the neighborhood to give information to experts. It's what doctors do. You know, you go, the patient gives you information, you say, oh, thank you, and then you take that information, you go, oh, well, that's not true, but this is true, and then you make a decision based upon that. And I think that the question is, where in this process can the neighbor try to input things that the engineers might not know?
Because you have Barrett Street Marsh, you have the retention basins that aren't being cleaned out, you've got the Connecticut River, you've got a brook behind us, you've got water coming down Gleason Road and Jackson Street, you've redirected water to the marsh. There's a lot of things, there's been a lot of development there too, apartments, Carlin Drive. They're always pumping on Barrett Street down below.
That's a sewer.
Yeah. But I don't know what that has. I think there are water issues in that whole area. And
right. My
concern is the next development, I guess. And how do we, I've seen people dig a foundation for a garage and hit a spring, a water spring, and there, it's just water under there. And I think some kind of study needs to be done of that whole area. You have a marsh in the center of Northampton, and does it make sense? It's been created. There may have been some wetlands there initially, but we have a marsh now.
Yeah.
And, you know, I don't know when we're going to have a lake or whatever.
Well, I honor your history of knowing when it was not a marsh.
I'm not looking for waterfront property.
Appreciate it.
Mark?
Is there a mechanism so that in a process like this where they go to the CONSCOM, DPW, Planning Board, that people get a notification, say the CONSCOM is meeting in 2 weeks, but then do they get a notification that the CONSCOM voted 5-2 and this is what they said? Or DPW has reviewed and issued a stormwater permit, and just so there's a notification to abutters so that if they feel it's applicable, they have an opportunity to say, oh, wait a minute, how did the stormwater pass? These DPW must have missed something because I've lived here all my life and I can tell them whatever.
There's the stormwater permitting is an administrative permit review, so there's no public notice.
Mm-hmm.
The Conservation Commission does issue, you know, that, well, the commission doesn't, the applicant is required to issue notification to the abutters as well as plan. So anytime there's a public hearing for a board, the abutters get notified.
And minutes. I mean,
and then
minutes result from that.
Would it be unduly cumbersome if development's over a certain size? Or I guess if a stormwater permit needs to be pulled, that abutters will be notified somehow of that process?
It's not part of the ordinance.
Ms. Murray?
You know, I don't think I'm looking for a hard and fast decision tonight on what you're going to do to address the issues raised, but I think just making note of it and maybe having another meeting amongst yourselves at some point or something to help make decisions rather than trying to decide.
I recognize the effort you've put in. I mean, I want to honor this.
Okay.
And the discussion, I think, has been good for us. And, you know, an opportunity to ask you questions was helpful.
Okay. I just didn't want you to feel as though you had to come up with a solution.
I don't know that you can.
We hardly ever get someone say that. I want to know right now.
Any other comments or just, okay. Any other questions of Mr. McDonald?
Thank you.
I was going to ask.
Oh, sorry.
It's super fast and probably doesn't have an answer. And it just kind of popped into my head about 15 minutes ago. But, you know, MassSave has this wonderful program for individuals to retrofit. Does DEP have any sort of program for homeowners like Ms. Murray, who maybe live on a parcel that's developed before stormwater standards, to add stormwater mitigation to their property? I mean, because that seems like a sort of complement to,
that would be nice,
you know, the new developments are doing their part.
Yeah.
And it's existing development for many, many generations that, you know, is that could probably benefit from additional mitigation, you know.
And it may be something that the DPW and the city takes on and as we build more capacity to do.
Yeah. I mean, even in terms of education about what some of the mitigation. Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't, you know, I live in a condo, so I think I hear our building has water in the basement, but I couldn't care less. It's like, it doesn't affect me at any level, but I'm sure that there are some things that can be added to various parcels that maybe existing homeowners don't even know about.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, you mentioned MassSave. I wish there was that kind of financial incentive as part of this.
Yeah.
We do offer a credit if you put in a rain garden on your property.
Yeah.
But it doesn't really offset the cost of it.
Right.
The payback is maybe 20, 30
years. Because the MassSave rebates are very substantial.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, they do incentivize
you're actually making
that kind of retrofit
back quickly.
As we start looking and getting serious about some tree replanting, though, I think there might be an opportunity to add that as a extra thing that we would be looking for places to put the additional tree stock.
Yeah, and certain neighborhoods to focus on that we want to try to, you know, mitigate.
Well, I guess one of my issues was having some kind of hydrology study done of that area to know what's going on, if there's something worse going on there, and should that impact the planning decisions in the future, I guess.
Could I hope for a Smith College engineering project sometime to do that for you?
That's a great idea.
I mean, the city's already taken steps towards doing, you know, the whole watershed study, I think, right, of the Barrett Street watershed.
Yes. We are looking more at the upper part and the flooding near Church Street, Stoddard Street, that area. But yeah, we're looking at the whole watershed area.
I wonder. I have two properties over on Murphy Terrace, which is sort of where we're talking about, and in both properties, there's water in the basement, and I've had to spend considerable amounts of money to mitigate that. And I would think that there would be sort of a wonderful thing to just be able to understand how many properties on all of these streets where there's a problem, is there water in basements? And that seems like a...
I hate to say it, there's a lot of neighborhoods
yeah.
Yeah. Perversely, that's going to prove the wrong thing, though. There was water in the basements
yes.
last year.
Yeah.
You know,
What
I'm interested in is whether we've affected that story going forward, and I don't know how to capture that practically. But that's the real worry that I'd love to get a window into.
Well, also houses were built in with where there was high groundwater, so that's never going away.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, it's not necessarily that there's new drainage problem running down the street or you know.
Yeah.
So
there's whole neighborhoods that were built on wetlands. So
yeah.
It's not a great history.
There's some open fields there that I'm sure will be developed
concern,
I guess, without doing some kind of study to see what is the impact of all of the development that's happened there.
And that's, you know, when Peg came in and talked to me, you know, I went over the technical standards and how our understanding of it and how it was meeting it. But there's a lot of her questions were kind of outside of that, these bigger, you know, bigger picture questions that one stormwater permit, it's difficult to address. How do you solve the wet problem in this whole neighborhood? Would we deny a project based on that, and how would we even, you know, what's the criteria?
Defend that decision.
Right.
Well, and the watershed is often bigger than the neighborhood.
It's much bigger. Yeah. It's much bigger. So it will be.
It will continue to be, yes.
But one other note I wanted to add is that, you know, had I attended the meeting, had I heard the comments, I think I would find myself saying, but it meets the standard. It meets the standard. So I'm still not sure how much that would have added to the discussion here. And in many ways, it's not us defending the project. It really should be the engineer that's representing the developer,
right,
defending the project. But helping to let the neighbors and the public know how we are reviewing it. We're always available to answer questions, but I agree. At what point in the process, and how do people know to even do that? We'll have to do some thinking to see if we can try to make that clear.
And again, as you know, in terms of the process, you know, we're talking about systemic issues that are neighborhood-wide, and then an individual project mm-hmm. that is before us for you know. So we have to, you know, we can't expand the scope of our decision and our discussion
right.
beyond the project. And you know, this discussion's been great to be able to talk about, like, okay, there is some bigger issue going on that maybe there are some other mechanisms we can use, but an individual applicant's hearing, you know, has to be focused on that
right.
application, you know,
right.
that specific application. You know, we can't, you know, that's part of the balance.
Disconnecting again from the neighbors and the others who have been there.
Right.
Well, I
I think that, but also, you know, again, the foundation of our private property is that, you know, if a parcel is available for sale and an individual comes to purchase that property and redevelop it, you know, they are submitting an application that we're reviewing. So it's not like there's, you know, this empty parcel and the city wants to bring everyone together as a group because we all commonly own it, you know, and we're all gonna have, you know, make equal decisions.
Well, there is, and in some ways, it's connected to the desire not to expand the utilities out into subdivisions, and so it's a two-edged sword, really. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity.
And I'm sorry, thank you.
Thank you.
We appreciate it.
Yeah, I did hand out a four-page summary that I hope you had a chance to read.
Oh, yes.
We did.
Try to raise them there as effectively as possible. I think some of the things I'd like to get some kind of response to, one way or another, and some thought. I think there are a number of issues that abutters and neighbors just need to have more information so they can be part of the process more and not be kind of the angry mob that comes in to lynch you. And in fairness to you,
it's a fun job.
And I think what triggered all of this was the Hinckley Street.
Right.
And you did have an angry mob. I couldn't materialize as many people as they did. But, you know, they have similar issues, I think. And it was an infill situation and a special permit. And so I think a lot of the issues may be the same. And it would be very worthwhile to get some of those abutters together to find out what. You're going to wind up with a lot of angry citizens in Northampton, I think, if you're not listening to the neighbors. And I think there are some definite gaps in the ability to hear what they have to say. So, thank you, though.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. We've got an A&R. Yes. Thank you. Good night. So we have an A&R for Main Street Leeds division under Mass General Law, Chapter 41, Paragraph 81L.
So this is the church on, is it on Main Street?
Main Street, yeah.
And the, there's a church building and, you know, that's been on the market. There's been a lot of discussion about what to do with this.
Well, I think as long as we
can. At lounge. oops, upside down, is that what you said?
No, I said as long as we, I think it's been for sale as long as we, the church has, the rectory has been last year, so.
So, this is a curious situation. So the, so they're proposing to essentially just carve off the rectory so they can sell that, because that's the easier piece to deal with. The problem is it's special conservancies. There is a provision to allow the reuse of historic structure, religious and educational uses with site plan approval if there's a reuse proposed for that historic building. And it could be non-residential if it helps preserve that building.
But the rectory is not.
Right, but also there hasn't been a proposal put forward, so this parcel that's being shown doesn't comply with the zoning until and unless the planning board approves a plan for reuse.
How about the church or the rectory?
The church.
Okay.
However, under subdivision rules, which are completely separate and they don't talk to zoning very well, under this provision that is noted on the agenda, you can create two parcels from one if it's for the purposes of separating structures onto their own lots. So, and that is allowed as an A&R. So the reason why I'm telling you this is that it's my recommendation that this plan be endorsed, but that it be written on clearly that this property is not buildable or usable under zoning because it hasn't been approved yet for a reuse plan. And so that's allowed under statute to, you can write any kind of notations on a plan, particularly if it's not meeting zoning. So I'm recommending that you approve the A&R because statutorily you're allowed to do that, subdivide a lot if it has two structures on it to make two separate parcels.
If we approve this, mm-hmm. would it make anything that's more restrictive on the use of the other piece than they already exist?
No, I mean, the biggest issue really is that it's in the floodplain.
Right.
So any improvements need to be, need to meet modern flood standards, building code, and all that stuff.
Which are
so even renovations to that residential structure.
Which are a lot different than what they were when it was built.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Right.
All right. But it won't make it worse than what it is right now.
No.
Okay. Mm-mm.
Nothing about the zoning is changed. That's a residential zone? Is that what?
No, it's a, well, so there's a line right here. This funky line here is the Special Conservancy District. So it actually covers most of these two buildings. Then around it is the Urban Residential B. But this is, the river is, the Mill River is down on the other side. Mm-hmm. But the FEMA mapped.
There's a business just like two doors down.
Right. That is, that there's that one spot, I think, of office industrial something because it was historically, okay. Yeah.
But
the rest of it is
okay.
Residential. I think that's right. I don't think it's non-conforming. At any rate, that puts this section into a completely different classification in terms of lot size requirements and frontage, because the Special Conservancy District is a place where the city has said we don't want to put any new residential uses, but existing residential uses can be treated differently because, you know, they've been there historically, so you know, it may be appropriate to continue that as opposed to allowing brand new. So what it does is, you know, if this doesn't get permanently protected, they'll be in a little bit of a quandary because they won't meet the lot size requirements under Special Conservancy for any new use. So
nor would the one carved off. I mean, that
right, that has to stay.
Right.
Yeah, residential.
Why do they want to separate them?
Because they have a buyer for the rectory. That's the easy one to get rid of. The church is the hard building.
So well, that's good they have a buyer.
A&R is approval not required, but
under subdivision rules.
But you're going to actually ask us to vote on this, or are you just looking for a nod?
So the A&R process, A&R stands for approval not required, meaning subdivision approval not required, but you all have to vote to endorse it and acknowledge that it's not a subdivision under subdivision rules.
So moved.
Dyer second from Tess. John moved second from Tess. All in favor? Thank you. We have two sets of minutes. I would
move approval.
Tell you that I have read them and
Recent.
Have approved them both.
Resets.
The record shows.
Goes way back to December and something else. There's three
sets.
December 8th.
Excuse me. Maybe I only read two. Do I hear an approval on the set of 3 minutes from Mark?
Yeah, second.
Second from John. All in favor of approving the minutes? Thank you.
Let's go.
Second.
John second. And recommended that we adjourn. Mark, John seconded. All in favor? Thank you.